In 1962, the German transistors, he created a new element. But the point is, he was very, very, very surprised that what happens is when you actually switch based on energy rather than based on signal. Like, you'll see everything we know about neural networks actually he already saw. So, what he didn't have was an algorithm to train those, and there was a bunch of work then, mostly to actually invent the back propagation algorithm. And what we should know though is, very important to know, since we are all basically just tuning those weights and when should we switch, right? It's nothing else but try and error, guess and check. It's incomplete, okay? So yes, back progression can be faster because we approximate, right? It's a smart way of approximating. But if you want to have the absolute best result, you gotta go through everything. Okay, so back progression is incomplete. Even for if you just do it for a single perception. And then Cook himself showed that knowing what function is implemented by a given network is at least something. Right? So that's basically what we know. So by the end of the talk, I want to extend this a little bit. And first of all, machine learners have a capacity that is measured universally. Okay? And I'm talking about supervised machine learners, but not that much. Just for now, supervised machine learners have a universal capacity. So, and by the way, breaking, going over that capacity creates an adversarial example. Actually, and this is what we're doing right now with Song, if that's the way you explain it, the way I talk. Anyway, so artificial neural networks with gating functions, sigma, gradle, etc. So we only looked at the ones that have gating function, not RDF network, not fuzzy network, these are all different. Have a capacity that can analytically cause. And despite the fact that you're all using doubles, we have one big parameter. Okay? It has to do with the fact that it can be -1 and 1 that makes the decision, I have to show that. Point is, we already see that in the community. They're asking actually to reduce the length of the flow to 8-bit. Why? Well, for training, you need for that approximation, because if you only just 1 bit, then we really have to go and be completely trying. But for the approximation that is back propagation, you can use less bits. But once you're trained, 1 bit makes the decision. It's just the time, really. So based on that, we have two critical points. Anybody a physicist here, by the way? Because you can almost leave right away, that's an Ising model. Okay. Ising model of Fermi. So this is like the Ising model, has two critical points that define behavior. So we have what we call the lossless memory dimension. This is the point, these are the number of parameters that will store everything you can ever put in there. We'll talk about that. Basically, that's sort of the memory capacity. And then we showed something else, which is the McKay dimension. And we call it McKay dimension because David McKay showed all of this for a single perceptron. And I'm going to go all over this. David McKay is a theoretical physicist. He was a scholar of Hopfield, so that might be Hopfield, I guess. So he knows what he's got. And the point is that McKay showed for the perceptron that these two literally looks like phase transitions exist for perceptrons and these scale perceptrons. But whatever you do, it scales linearly in a number of ways. The architecture you use all of this, you can just hurt it. It can just get worse. Okay, information speaking. So, and it's completely independent of the architecture. It's like, whatever we use, you can make the epitome good architectures and bad architectures, but we only look at the best case here, okay? So in the very best case, this is the most one. Right? But it's interesting because predicting and measuring these two critical points allows us an independent evaluation, independent of the data and of the task, and comparing machine learning. Right. So you have this situation, you use YFCC 100M with 100 million images, you have a full result, and then somebody comes back from a conference and says, ha, we're using this and this L something regularization, or this and this. Now the question is, okay, let's try it. Right? So you put it in, and then you need to run a whole experiment again. And then it's 5% better, or 5% worse, and you ask yourself, You have to tune the parameters, or what is it? Maybe I didn't hire a buck, right? You don't know anything. Well, with that, you can just measure the capacity. The capacity went down. You don't want to use that, right? So now, let's start from scratch. The perception, right? This is our base unit, which is nothing else inside here. So if you want to take a look at this, I have an X, I'm having the electrons, right? So X is the signal, and the sum of X is the energy if you load this up. And your weights is the scalar on the signal for each of them, which is, of course, great for every time you can be more fine than anyone. But in any way, what you're asking yourself is that dot product greater than or smaller than a bias, but if you have a threshold on that end of the interest right here. Okay? So the most important thing to take away here is you have this sum WR, the weights times the input, right? And you ask yourself, am I greater or smaller than a bias in this activation? So now, we all know that this is one type of activation, right? There's other activation too. In fact, if you go to Wikipedia, oh my god, there's so many activation functions. So now, here's how I explain this for simple. The thing that makes the decision, and we'll look at this in a bit, is this, okay? Greater or smaller than zero, okay? So the way I say it is, the boss makes the decision, you are fired. It can smooth it. You can go ahead and say you're fired or you're not fired. Or you can ask, I don't know, an assistant to say, can you break this to them nicely, but they're fired. So now, breaking it to them nicely is what the activation, what these smoothing functions do. They don't make decisions. They just smooth, okay? That's basically what it is. And it may help sometimes for learning. But for the capacity, it does exactly nothing. So, then let's talk about what is the purpose of neural network order perceptron. And we have some questions. So, neural networks memorize and optimize the function from somebody else to somebody else. Okay? So ultimately, all the machine learners supervised, all the supervised machine learners, nothing else, which is like it's an F function from data to labels. Okay? And so now the mathematical summary questions are like, okay, so there's a minimum amount of parameters to memorize that function. Right? So the interesting thing here is when we put maths up like this, it mostly we put it on paper and don't think about the fact anymore. But even if I just say f of x is x squared, I need some memory to store that function. Okay? I put it on paper. Okay. So, basically the first question is,